Meeting this man was tremendous. Bill Ersin said you need to have Bishop Wagner preach it because of the times. And we did 3 years ago, and oh, what a message. And we've asked him, the committee talked about it, we wanted Bishop Wagner to come back. It's a lasting friendship. He's preached for this church. He will not leave his home church on Sunday. But the Pentecostals just had a way of reaching out. He's an apostolic preacher. He's Jesus' name, one God. Believes a new birth message, and he's sold on it. He's got a Holiness Living Church. Last 2 years, I've keynoted his convention, Pentecost in Perspective. Powerful, powerful convention. I love him. His church loves him. I want him to take his liberty tonight and preach to him. Would you welcome to this pulpit a man of God, great Christian, and a preacher of the book, Bishop Norman Wagner, the PFW.
God bless you. You may be seated. I have highly been favored of the Lord to be a part of because of the time. And tonight, especially, I have dined royally while God, the masterful chef, sent the delectable word through Brother Lee. I want him to know that I, and I'm certain many others, appreciate the time that you labored before the Lord, because that word couldn't come any place else but from the Lord. To this great conference, your presiding prelay in his absence, Brother Ersin, who called me a few minutes ago on his way out of town, and to the pastors of this church, Elder G.A. Mangum, and that dynamo wife of his, Sister Vesta Mangum. And to those who now have the baton, Elder Anthony Mangum and Sister Mickey Mangum, I have to tell you, this is an outstanding church. Now, we have had in Calvary Sister Mangum come and minister to the conclave. And when she finished, we all knew that a daughter of Zion had been there. Then Brother Anthony has come two times, to be honest with you. They kind of think he's the second pastor. I want him to get the word I said, second pastor. When he goes there, they treat him like he's the first pastor. But he has been outstanding, and we've met the daughter of Zion, and when he got there, we met the son of thunder. I just got one left. I've met the daughter of Zion, the son of thunder. I got to get G.A. Thunder himself there. The Lord bless you all real good. He has done great things. Everybody say, He has done
great things.
Everybody say, He has done
great things.
Bless His holy name. Sisters say He's done.
He has done great things.
If you mean it, just say it.
He has done great things. He has done great things.
We can't be outdone. Our turn. Let's go.
He has done great things
for you and for me.
He has done great things
that the entire world may see.
He has done great things. Bless His holy name.
Everybody say, bless the Lord. Blessings of the Lord be upon you. Would you please gather your Bibles? And I'm desirous tonight of you turning to two passages. They do not suggest longevity, they just suggest maybe clarity. The passages that we shall read is Isaiah, the 14th chapter. And after you have found that passage, please go to the book of Numbers, the 24th chapter. If you have followed my instructions, you will end in Numbers, and we will examine that passage first. It is because of the sacredness of the word of the Lord and our holding to the tradition of Ezra that we stand to our feet for the hearing of the word. Numbers 24, hear ye the word of the Lord. I'm beginning with verse 14. And now behold, I go unto my people. Come therefore, and I will advertise thee what this people shall do to thy people in the latter days. And he took up a parable and said, Balaam the son of Beor hath said, And the man whose eyes are open has said, he has said, which heard the words of God and knew the knowledge of the Most High, which saw the vision of the Almighty falling into a trance, but having his eyes open. I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not now. And there shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and shall smite the corners of Moab, and destroy all the children of Sheth. Isaiah 14, please. Verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cast down, cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nation? And all the people said,
amen.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
An examination of the two passages, so-called, in the 17th verse of the 24th chapter of Numbers, there shall come a star of Jacob. And I want to pick up where my yoke partner tonight left off. With that key, he talked about authority. There's another word for authority in the Bible. It's called scepter. And the scepter shall rise from Israel. Then we heard in Isaiah, after the stars rising in Numbers, how art thou fallen from heaven? The NIV would say here, son of the morning star. The morning star, Lucifer. And of the dawn. My contribution to Because of the Times has been given to me to give to you by direct assignment from God. We do not want any of you preachers, leaders, teachers, evangelists, workers to leave here just having had a great time.
Amen.
The thousands upon thousands of dollars that this meeting has cost, ladies and gentlemen, was not designed for you to just have a great time. But the orchestrators received the mind of God and had something in mind. And I share with you from these two passages, you might think upon this message under the name Star Wars. Star Wars. Just pray with me a moment. Father, in Jesus' name, we stand before this glorious people with an awesome task. We find ourselves possessed with human inability to articulate a divine gospel. We are in need of a touch from God. Send your word and send your power. Send the anointing. And touch these lips of clay. We shall ever praise thy name. Now I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in thy sight. You're my Lord, my strength, and my Redeemer. In Jesus' name. Amen. Star Wars. 93 million miles catapulted from the earth, exists the brilliance of what is known as the greatest star in this galaxy. We call it normally not a star, though it is a star. We call it the sun. Nigh unto us, less than 93 centimeters away, is the greatest star of the church galaxy. We call it not a star. We call it the sun. S-O-N. To comprehend tonight's message takes us to a realm beyond the natural. Pentecostals are people who are born beyond the natural. You must be very careful that you do not allow your natural lineage to impact your spiritual birth. You see, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, that which you were born of naturally cannot affect your spiritual birth. For saints to have to now confess and talk and bring up how they were abused when they were a child and they can't get over this, and how this happened to them and how that happened to them, and the psychologist tells us that's a healthy thing for people in the natural. For people in the church, it's a damnable thing. To understand the Pentecostal message, you must be born again. It's to understand more than a stair step to heaven. You must remember that Jesus said, you must be born again. Now, the reason for that is to put you into the galaxy of the stars and to get you beyond the terrain of the natural. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Jesus said, remember, that which is born of flesh is flesh. He said, that's one kingdom and one law. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, every kingdom has its law. For the word kingdom comes from two words, king's domain. A kingdom is the domain of the king. It is where the ecclesiastical writer says, where the word of a king is, there is power. Now, Yeltsin has power in Europe, but his word has no power in the United States of America. He would be out of his kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to learn that things of our past, all of the problems that happened to our past, the things that enslaved us in the past, were of the other kingdom. Glory to God. They had no power over us in this kingdom. I would like just for a moment to talk to a few of you college students and to remind you, in comprehending this text, of the Australian monk that you possibly studied, who is considered the father of genetics. His name is Gregor Johann Mendel. You remember Mendel's law says that everyone that is born is the immediate product of his two immediate progenitors. He says we have the characteristics and the nature of our two immediate progenitors. He said when one is active, the other is latent but yet present. Now, should you not understood Mendel, hear Norman. What he said is this. This is what he said. Everybody who is born has all of their mama in them and all of their daddy in them. Everything your mama was, you are. Everything your daddy was, you are. That's Mendel's law, Norman's way. In understanding this now, whatever you have received then in the natural from your father or mother is in you. We can look at you and get an idea what your father looks like. We can look at you and tell what your granddaddy looked like. We can look at you. We have received the genes and the chromosomes, and they have dictated our DNA. Now, ladies and gentlemen, because all of that comes from Adam, you might as well hear what I'm saying. We all come out of one blood, whether you are light, black, pretty, or ugly. All of that is one blood. Now, what the Lord said, because that has been contaminated, that must die. The only way that you can get out of paying taxes, you gotta die. Otherwise, you are tied to that kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, the only way you get out of paying the devil his due, you have to die to the world. Now listen to me. Listen to me. And so you will see here that, ladies and gentlemen, that that's the message in John 3. Jesus said, you must be born again, because what you have been created for to do, stand up, young man, stand up. You look mighty sharp there. Come on up here. Stand up here since you look so sharp. Now, what God has commissioned you to do, it's on you, and that's what, because of the times, is for, to bring to you the knowledge of destiny. You see, destiny wasn't created for you. You were created for destiny. The Lord knows that our grandparents and our friends and all that bloodline cannot help us do a spiritual work. It's too messed up. Child abuse, all of the things that we hear about today, there's just too much messed up in our blood, too much for us to do a spiritual work. But the Lord says you must be born again so that now you will become the product of your two immediate progenitors. That progenitor is God our Father and the church that we are birthed as soon as Zion travails. She'll bring forth. So, brothers and sisters, it brings us then to understand we are now where Paul says, sitting in heavenly places. In order to operate the key that was so graphically illustrated before us, you must be in a heavenly place. The reason the key is so large, You don't come down to where I am to help me. You send the key down and you stay up in a heavenly place. Now what we have here is understanding that Paul says we have different stratas of life. The Bible tells us in the book of the Hebrews that the earth is designed from a pattern of the heavenlies. And he says to understand that, look at the tabernacle. He says, as it operates in the tabernacle, that's how things operate in the heavenlies. When we deal with the tabernacle of Israel, we have, ladies and gentlemen, remember, an instrument that God will occupy. The entire purpose of the tabernacle was to have a means by which God could dwell among us. Follow it now. The reason for the tabernacle. Later, when you have an opportunity, you can check it in the 25th chapter of Exodus, about the 8th verse. You will see here that God has it. God told Moses, I want you to build me a tabernacle that I may dwell among you. If you do not build it, I will not be with you when you pass through the waters. If you do not build it, then I can't be with you when you pass through the rivers. But if you build me a tabernacle, then I will dwell among you. Now, sometimes, every now and then, I hear someone messing with the text on the ark, and they will explain that God told Noah, build me an ark. Noah, God didn't tell Noah to build him an ark. God wasn't drowning. He told Noah, build yourself an ark. But the tabernacle is exclusively God's to dwell among the people. Now, when we understand the Christ, follow me now, the Christ was built. Remember, it was made of a woman. The Christ was built, ladies and gentlemen, for one reason, that he may dwell among us. Christ was not built just for us to wear Christ on our lapel. He was not built just to say we are Christians. But the Pentecostal people must hear me clearly that Jesus has come to us in his name that he may dwell among us and that he may war for us against every spirit of wickedness that's coming against the church. When we look here carefully, we will see that he says, I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not nigh. There shall come a star. Ladies and gentlemen, an examination of the star and its purpose takes us back to the fourth day of creation. Let us remember, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. Then he says, and God said, let us make light. Let there be light. Ladies and gentlemen, he uses the term, let there be light. And there was light. Now, my brother, if you continue to examine that first chapter of Genesis, you will notice that everything else God made, and he said, this is good. He made that, and this is good. But in that third verse, he doesn't make that light. He says, let there be light, and there was light. Why, he couldn't have made that light when he explains to us in Matthew and John, I am the light of the world. He couldn't make himself. What he was saying was, let God enter into the cosmos that has now become confused and condemned. And let God, when he entered, bring light and show us how to straighten out the mess that we are in. So, brothers and sisters, that is on the first day. He then has to separate the heavens from the earth. He makes two distinct communities. You have to see, my sister, you have to see there has to be a distinction between the earthly and the heavenly. Saints are trying to amalgamate the two to one. They want to pretend we're all saved, we're all going to heaven, everybody's my brother. You might be my cousin, but you're not my brother if you don't have the name. You might be my cousin, but not my brother. Ladies and gentlemen, hey, glory to heaven. So you have to see here that he says there's got to be a difference between the holy and the profane. On the third day, remember, he makes vegetation and places that in the earth. Now on the fourth day is what we're trying to hurry to. When he comes to the fourth day, that's the day that we must pay attention to. Every number in God has significance. Amen. When we deal with number one, it always deals with oneness. When we deal with number two, it deals with balance. When we deal with three, it deals with manifestation of deity. When we come to number four, we talk about order. Order. The Lord, ladies and gentlemen, has order. Four corners of the earth. It means order. So here, the Lord puts in order the earth. And the Bible says there in that first chapter, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of heaven too. This is the responsibility of the lights. Divide the day from the night. They are to be sanctified. The Hebrew word sanctified means not that we shout and speak in tongues and dance. It means declare it belongs to God. So when a person says, I'm sanctified, they are saying, I declare I belong to God. That has to be. Let them be for signs and for season and for days and for years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. Now notice, God sets us in heavenly places. We are set in heaven to minister on the earth. We are not to be on the earth, ladies and gentlemen, trying to tell a heavenly message and acting earthly. We are always to be heavenly. The manner of our dress is to be heavenly. Our speech is to be heavenly. And so, brothers and sisters, there are those who say, well, we cannot win them unless we act like them. Who told you that? God. No, your God is who I call my devil. So the Bible says, and God made two great lights. The greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night. And notice, he made the stars also. There are the three again. That manifestation, he made the stars also. So the lights that God made for his exclusive galaxy is the greater light, the sun, that rules the day, the lesser light, the moon that rules the night, and he made the stars also. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that greater light is the Son, S-U-N. But that greater light is also the Son, S-O-N. It is the center of the galaxy. It is by the Son that we receive seven forms of energy. It is by the Son that we receive our heat. It is by the Son we receive rays that come into the earth and grants us vegetation. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, we live by the Son. So here the Son is the greater light. Now you must see the greater light rules the day. In our time, we will see here, ladies and gentlemen, that the daytime is operated by a man called Adam. If we are talking about seven dispensations or seven periods of time, the first time we normally call law, and the second time we call grace. Now notice, the Bible points out that God made Adam, but the Bible says when he made man, it was not good. That's the only thing God said wasn't good. And what wasn't good? That man should try to do the will of God alone. The church must have a covenant partner. There must be covenant partners. So here, God made Adam. But ladies and gentlemen, in Adam we have A-D-A-M. Only four letters. It is incomplete. He cannot do it. It takes seven to make the week. And so the Bible says he had to make Eve. E-V-E. Adam's four, Eve's three, makes seven. Here, ladies and gentlemen, we have now the full day. Adam came for the day to give us light during the day. He taught the scriptures, taught the word for the day. But then, ladies and gentlemen, we have Eve who comes. Now, Jesus the Christ is called the last Adam, not simply the second Adam. There will be no other Adams after him. The last Adam. So Jesus is seen in Adam. Watch it now. Jesus came and brought unto us the new gospel. He brought unto us, ladies and gentlemen, light. He brought unto us truth. We were in the glory of the day when Jesus healed the sick and raised the dead. 5,000 hungry souls he fed. But you must remember, that's only counting the men, and they were over 20. So the 5,000, they all in the Jewish economy. They pushed the brothers to get married at a young age, usually in their teenage days. So it's easy to assume that the 5,000 men had 5,000 wives. One wife apiece, that is. Don't get too happy. They had one wife apiece. So that's 10,000. And if, ladies and gentlemen, the couples had about three children, that would be 15,000. So Jesus probably fed at least 25,000 people out of five loaves and a couple of five fish and a couple of loaves of bread. Here, ladies and gentlemen, we see that Jesus represents the morning. Do you see it? The morning of the day. He is the Adam. Now, the first letter of Adam is what? Let me hear it. And the last letter of Adam is what? Put them together. What is it? A.M. Adam represents the A.M. of the morning. Now, Jesus represented the AM of what we've got to do with that key. He represents the AM of it. But then the sun set and it went down. We just saw it. The cross is down now. The sun set. So the great light was gone. But he said, don't worry. Zechariah caught a glimpse.
said, don't worry about it. God's got an instrument that will bring light in the eventide. And here comes Eve bringing about that light. Adam, ladies and gentlemen, is found in the Christ. The Christ. But Eve is found in the church. It is the church that must give light to the night because of the times. Let us examine further now that the Bible said, and he made the stars also. Now we must see there is a great distinction between the sun and the moon. The sun, remember I told you, is according to the physicists, the sun, ladies and gentlemen, is a star. It is the largest star. So the sun is a star and stars are stars. So they are of the same. Back to Mendel's law. The stars he made also come from the same stock of the sun that he made. Now you must remember, the moon is in between. The moon is not a star. The star, from their gases, innately give light by themselves. But the moon is not a star. It cannot give light. It can only give light if it's in right position with the sun to reflect the rays from the sun to the earth. So many times we become confused and we get disenchanted with what we call the church. Don't get disenchanted. It just has had an eclipse for a moment. Ladies and gentlemen, you see, don't leave the church. Don't get discouraged. Some of you are saying, I wish my church was like Brother Mangum's church. And because my pastor's not like this pastor, I'm going to leave my church. Wait. You say, but Brother Wagner, you don't understand it. We don't preach the whole gospel. And we're letting this come in. And we're letting that go. And all of that's happening in my church, I'm going to leave. Wait. Just wait. Your church is a moon. It goes through changes. First, it's a full moon, preaching the whole Pentecostal doctrine. Then it becomes a half moon, because some of the deacons got out of their place. Then it becomes a quarter moon, because the choir's messing up the whole spirit in the church. And then it becomes a crescent, when the young people are out of control. But if you just stay still, in 29 and a half days, it will return to a full church. Yes. Yes. If we can see this now, ladies and gentlemen, I must not keep you too long, but I want you to see this. If we can see this. So God made the stars also. That's next on the agenda. After the sun sets, after the moon has gone through its changes, then it's time for the stars. Somebody said, but we're in the midnight. Makes no, never mind. Ladies and gentlemen, the darker the night, the brighter the light. This is now time for the apostolic church to come of age and understand that our source is exclusively of Jesus. That's the power of our light. We have no light if we don't have the stuff that makes the light. We've got to have Jesus. You have to hear me. You have to hear me. Nowadays, some people who have attempted to take our name and call themselves Pentecostal, but they are quick to explain to you, I am a Catholic Pentecostal. I am a Baptist Pentecostal. I'm one of you, but I'm a Methodist Pentecostal. I'm one of you. I'm a Presbyterian Pentecostal. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, it is improper to put any adjective before anything that relates to Jesus. You got to hear me. We do the best we can because that's our human way. We call him wonderful Jesus and glorious Jesus, but that's improper. When you say Jesus, you say it all. I might suggest to you that you get in a habit of saying Jesus is wonderful, but Jesus needs no adjectives to try to describe him. Now, listen to me. If you are Pentecostal, the only way you can be Pentecostal, you have to deny yourself. Listen carefully. So if you were Catholic, when you became Pentecostal, you gotta drop that and carry Pentecost. There is nothing, you cannot come and bring labels with you. Pentecost is not a label. Pentecost is the life of Christ and God in us. Hallelujah! So we see here, ladies and gentlemen, that now in the nighttime, we need the stars. We need the stars. It is for this reason that Jesus is the one that picks up the bloodline that our pastor earlier explained to us. You must remember, ladies and gentlemen, that Saul had taken the kingdom, and Saul attempted to carry the scepter or the baton in the 440 relay race. But ladies and gentlemen, when Saul got over the finishing line, he was disqualified, even though he was the first one over. If you've ever ran the 440 relay race, you know it's not your foot that wins the race. Ladies and gentlemen, it's what you're carrying. You've got to have the baton or the scepter. Your foot brings it over, but it's not the first foot over. It's the one that has the baton. It's the first baton over. Many folk look like that they are outrunning the Pentecostal church. They have built this and done this and did the other. But ladies and gentlemen, at the finishing line, they will be disqualified because they don't have the original scepter or the original baton. You have to have the original. You have to have the original. And so they buried Saul. But God had passed the baton to a young son of Jesse, whose name was David. David got the baton, and remember, after his ordination, he asked his dad, "Is that all? Is that all? They've anointed him king now. Is that all?" "Yes, sir." "Well, so why are you in such a hurry, David?" "I got to get back to my sheep and get back to my business." When you are anointed, you will not keep pushing people. "Use me, use me." Just sit down and go back to your sheep. God will call you when it's time for you to be anointed. They look now for a star. The devil works havoc in the earth. 4,000 years, the prophets, they do the best they can do. But the earth is filled with disease. 4,000 years, the priests did what they could do. But they got infested with priests in the organization that took bribes and lost the purpose of their being. 4,000 years they raised the money but didn't raise souls out of hell, until the Bible says It ended in a curse. The last word in the book of the Old Testament canon is a curse. So the whole system, the Levitical system, the entire thing ended in a curse. It ended with the ark lost. It ended with the glory of God gone from the temple. It ended, ladies and gentlemen, with the light shining bright. So the Bible tells us when we enter the New Testament, they could not see. It was dark. Why? The Bible said because Jesus hid himself. He hid himself in the field. He was a pearl walked over by men, ladies and gentlemen. He hid himself. But he hid himself because the people to whom he had entrusted the revelation of the oneness refused to glorify him. The people whom he had entrusted with the revelation that he was Jehovah refused to honor him. The people whom he had entrusted with the revelation that I'm El Shaddai, I am God Almighty, I am the God not only who is the law, I am the maker of the law. You see, ladies and gentlemen, in parliamentary procedure, we can make a law, but the lawmakers also can say, look, we want to change our mind. So one stands and says, Brother Chairman, he has to be one of the lawmakers. I move that we suspend the laws. You can hear that you have cancer, but you got to get a hold to what I'm saying. You don't even have to worry about the cancer. Too many of us are focusing in on cancer. That is corruption. You don't always need to pray the cancer out of somebody. Pray them out of the cancer. Get them above the law of the thing. You have to hear me. I want to make sure you understand this. I had a man in Mount Calvary that was strong and robust and probably weighed over 300 pounds. I'm not talking about fat and flab, strong. And this man, when he came to the church, he wanted to be saved, and God saved him. Now, ladies and gentlemen, he had something that was troubling him, and he went to the doctor, and they said, we can't find anything wrong with you. And he said, well, I sometimes lose my appetite. That went on, for a year or more. Then, ladies and gentlemen, regretfully, the young man backslid, 30-some years old, went back in the world. Went back in the hospital with the same thing that he had gone in for the church. The doctor called me personally and said, Bishop, we've got a problem here. I said, Doctor, I'll be right there. I turned my car around and went to the hospital. Upon arriving, a specialist, one of the finest specialists in the United States, he said to me, Bishop Wagner, we got a phenomenon that we cannot explain. I said, what's the problem? He said, this guy is filled with cancer, filled with it. I said, oh no, etc. He said, but no, this is what I'm trying to explain to you. He said, you remember when he was at your church? Yes. And you remember when he was faithful there? Yes. And you remember how he got sick before and came in? Yes. And he came back one time? Yes, I remember all that. That was about 5 years ago. He said, Bishop, we gave him every test, CAT scans, every single thing, and we couldn't find anything. I looked at him and I said, well, the reason you couldn't find it, he said, Bishop, this had to have been there for years. This is a case, he had to have this years to be all over his body. He had it, ladies and gentlemen, for years, but when he was in the church, the blood covered him and listened and insulated him, where the death of the thing that he had no power in the kingdom he was in. A lot of us are sick right now and don't know it because the name of Jesus is keeping us alive. to heaven. It is here, brothers and sisters. It is here that in the New Testament we need light in a dark age, and that light is the star. We looked for a star and couldn't find it. You see, the devil was working havoc in the celestial kingdom. But then we looked and couldn't find the star. The Jewish brethren were supposed to tell us about it, but they didn't tell us about it. So God picked up a Gentile by the name of Balaam, and God made a heathen a prophet. And God took the Gentile, a person that was not a person, and said, prophesy. The church that's supposed to tell it don't see it, so they can't tell what they don't see. So Balaam stood up to curse Israel, and as he tried several times, finally God made him know, this is my people, and you can't curse them. So Balaam stood up and said, Balak, you're dealing with the people of God, and I cannot curse them. Balak said, I'll give you my whole kingdom filled with gold. He said, if you gave me everything, I cannot do what the Lord will not allow me. What a lesson to remember. The devil cannot do what the Lord will not allow him. And so, brothers and sisters, he said, I saw this vision because of the times that will come. In the latter day, because of the dark ages, because there will be a man that allegedly will go around and kill 16 boys and cut off their heads and mutilate their bodies and put their heads in the refrigerator. Because of the time that they that have been our idols will be accused of rape. Because of the times that another man will be a doctor but will give you a method to help you kill yourself. Because of the time when divorce will be as common in the church as it is in the world. Because of the time when many preachers will lose sight of the Jesus they preach and become more concerned with their political personal agenda. Because of the time, he said, I see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not nigh. But there shall come a star, and the star is going to come out of Jacob. This star is going to come, and it's going to war with the star of the morning, that's what Lucifer means, shining one, star of the morning. This star that will come out of Jacob will fight with the star of the morning. And he said, not only that, this he will bring the scepter with him. He's going to have the key. He's going to have the authority. It will be upon his shoulder. This one will have the authority because he is the star of the stage, and he has the scepter or the key on his shoulder. And when he comes to forgive sins, somebody will look at Bill and say, what do you mean you are forgiven? You are as dirty as I was or am. But Bill will say, I was baptized in Jesus' name, and I was infilled with the Holy Ghost. And John will say, well, what does that have to do with it? He said, Jesus forgave me. He said, I don't understand how any one man can forgive you. He said, he's got the key the scepter on his shoulder. He said, I still don't understand. Well, by having the key on his shoulder, he has the whole government authority. He is the government. You remember what he said? Ladies and gentlemen, he made us understand a virgin is going to conceive and bring forth a son. Now unto us, a son, ladies and gentlemen, a child is born and a son is given. You will notice the child is born. Now, Elder, that's Mary's child. So that's his humanity. Humanity can only be born, ladies and gentlemen, but the son is given. The son's not born. The son is divinity. That's where Mendel's law comes. He received an earthly body from Mary, but he's got his divinity from God. He is the Almighty God. So a child is born, but a son is given. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Oh, clap your hands and praise him. I'm almost finishing. Glory to heaven. I'm almost finished. I want you to see here what I'm saying here. That you've got to see here that this Jesus is the Christ. He is the star that war against the devil. Remember, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. That's the part I want to get to, where we are in a spiritual warfare. The star Jesus showed us how to war. Now, they don't war like Mike Tyson or Evander Holyfield. That's men fighting with their hands. Stars are lights. This is a light war. It's laser time. I can imagine how angels fight. It would be something like Zorro. It's star. It's lights going, ladies and gentlemen, that cuts down. So the Lord brought it down, and the Bible said that we saw Satan fall from heaven, the star that had dominated this earth. He fell from heaven because he was in a star war. And the superstar defeated the demonic star. And the Bible said, how art thou fallen? We looked and Jesus said, I saw him fall like lightning. When I put what I had on him, he fell like lightning. So now the Lord is saying to us that now there are new stars rising. You are a star, and we are stars, and I'm a star. I know what you're saying, but Brother Wagner, I'm insignificant. I can't sing. I can't preach. I hardly know how to pray. I'm so little in the body of Christ. Listen to me. Just twinkle, twinkle, little star. Matters not what you are. Up above the world so high, you're like a diamond in the sky. You've got to see here that God is saying that the power is in the name of Jesus. Now you've got to be the same as Jesus. Jesus is the Almighty Christ. You got to hear what I'm saying now. When you talk about being a star, you have to be the same essence of the sun. The star must be the same essence of the sun. Don't be afraid of what I'm getting ready to tell you. Jesus is the sun, but the sun was not Jesus. Jesus, anytime I'm in an apostolic church and say this, they get real nervous. But I want you to hear me. The Son, ladies and gentlemen, died. Jesus never dies. You see here that Jesus is the Son of God. that son represents the Christ. That's what I want you to see. And the Christ means the anointed one or the anointed flesh of God. It is the body. When we see that body, we see there's Mike. That's not Mike, that's his body. His body identifies Mike on the inside. The Christ was caught by men. The Christ was nailed to a cross. But Jesus was still God. A God that cannot die. A God that can't be destroyed. And a God that can never come down. So what he says here, he says you don't see how your situation is going to work out. You see no way that this thing will work for you. But God said, let not your heart be troubled. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when he says heart, it's the same word. Let not your mind be confused. Be careful that you don't try to use logistic processes. Be careful that you don't try to use the principle of deduction and induction reasoning. When you come to God, you can't reason why. You gotta do or die. You just gotta say, I believe. I don't know how it's going to work it out, but I believe. So he said, let not your heart be troubled. Don't become confused. Don't let the circumstance confuse the opportunity for a miracle. Trouble is only an avenue for a miracle. Ladies and gentlemen, then he gives us a command. He didn't do like many folk misquoted. If you believe in God, there's no if. He gave an emphatic command. He said, believe in God. Don't worry about this mess. Believe in God. Then he said, and also believe in the Christ. Believe in the manifestation of God on the earth. Believe in the moon. Believe in the star. Believe in what you see. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. Now, this Father's house is not heaven. Heaven is not the Father's house. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. That's not the Father's house. The Father had one house. He told us, my house is the temple. And if you destroy this body in 3 days, I'll raise it up again. He said, in my Father's house, in Christ, in preaching Jesus, there are many mansions or rooms. There are many revelations. There's more than water baptism. There's more than speaking in tongues. There's more than singing. There's more, there's more, there's more. There's more than just waving a hand. But you have power. Let God use you. And so you have to see it's in the name of Jesus. Please, my young preachers, I pray that we're giving you a good lineage. But if we're not, don't get caught up with buildings, fine clothes and cars. It's all right, but above everything else, you gotta have Jesus. It's Jesus, in the name of Jesus, devils have come down, in the name of Jesus, your child will be set free, in the name of Jesus, you will be able to get out of what you're in. It's in his name, that name, that's above every name. Heaven and earth, that name that brought us out of darkness. Everybody say Jesus.
Jesus.
Or just slap your hand and start praising God. Lift him up. I said lift him up. I said lift him up. I said lift him up. Lift him up. Get a hold to the name of Jesus. I said get a hold to the name of Jesus. And lift him up. You have to see it. You have to see it, ladies and gentlemen. Lift him. Everybody help me. Lift him up. Say it again, help me. Lift him up. Say it again, help me. Lift him up. Say it again, just help me. I wonder will you help me. Say it again, just help me. Lift him up. It's higher. Talking about today. Star Wars. You now take over the war. When you leave this place, your greatest weapon is the light of Jesus' name. You have to hear what I'm saying. Your God is the only God. They talk about the miracle of resurrection, but he's the only being in the world that can choose when he's going to die. He said, I'm going to lay down and die right now. Set his own alarm clock for 36 hours and says, I'm getting up out of here. Glory! And now, he makes you the light. I want you to use your light. The doctors are finding that they can heal disease with lasers. That's light, son. Traveling 186,000 miles per second. That's light. We've got light here. We've got light. If you can just send the light into somebody, God can send full deliverance. Just somebody next to you, lay your hands on them and say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I send the light. I cast out darkness. Star Wars.